All right, today on BRStv's Top Fails, it's fish. Half of our reef tanks are actually the fish and all little critters that live in there, and they all rely on us to actually have a really fast learning curve, which sadly, a lot of us don't, and it isn't good for our pets. But in this case, you can take decades of our failures and apply them to your own lessons so you can actually avoid those failures and have a much more successful tank.
So in our mistakes videos, we usually say that most reefers have done like one of these or some of these, but in this case, we've done most of these, or many of us have. So let's just be better for the future of our hobby and future reefers by learning from our mistakes.
So the first one, I'm just gonna say it like it is. There's a lot of people, when they first enter the hobby, they just don't consider fish to be the same type of pet as their cat or dog and the responsibility that comes with that. But they are not disposable. They are absolutely our pets. They like require us to take care of them. They expect and rely on us to think about their benefit. And so it's really on us to make sure that we think about and take on this glass box with that kind of responsibility and making sure that these are our pets. We name them, we care for them. They'll be with us for decades in some cases. And at least if we do it right, and we should really, really think about it that way. All right, so number two, the most important thing that you probably do in your whole setup of the tank is...
Yeah, the mistake here is not making a fish list or a fish plan. This is something that I've personally done while I was deployed and I was getting my tank ready. I just went through the different types of fish, their interactions, and you know, are they reef safe? Are they not reef safe? Are they grow too big for my system? Will they be too small? Do they work better in numbers? There's just so much planning here that you can put into place. Have a fish plan before you get your tank going.
Yeah, so this super, super important. Like, and not only, you only have so many fish, so think about it beforehand, like which ones I'm gonna do. You're also gonna do a little bit of coordination then, which ones will go in first. So make sure when you set up a new tank, have a plan. Don't just go willy-nilly buying them from the store and just hoping for the best. Have a plan of where you wanna go, and that will help you get there. Number three, especially for a reef tank, is?
Yeah, this is not considering utilitarian fish first. In this case, I mean, this is kind of something new to me, a concept to me in the last couple years, specifically because of the WWC BRS hybrid series, in that, you know, utilitarian fish are also a major part, if not the most major part, to your cleanup crew, and you should plan for them to be in there first and then maybe get a couple decorative fish.
Yeah, so here's the thing. Get fish that like to eat algae, like tangs. Get fish that like to eat parasitic copepods, like, you know, wrasses, like a chorus wrasse. Get fish that likes to eat aptasia, like a filefish from the beginning. And a lot of these things you may like have in your tank, but you'll never even know it because the fish are eating them before they ever become a problem. Wrasses like those also eat nudibranchs and stuff. So things that, like problems in the tank that you may actually have, you'll never even know about. Number four for me is one I've actually failed on myself. I just don't think about this enough.
Yeah, the fail here is not thinking about color and the color that the fish provide to the tank. I mean, this is a living piece of art, and as much as I love those colorful, you know, vibrant corals and sticks, my fish are a part of that too, and there is a variety of colored fish, the colors of fish that can really accent your tank, make it pop out.
Yeah, so there's lots of corals. The predominant color with coral tends to be green, right? But like getting some of those yellows and reds and stuff. There are corals in that color, but like if we can get a whole school of like anthias in there, or school of purple or yellow tangs and stuff, it adds color like and movement to the tank. So think about how you know you're gonna add that like pop using fish to your reef tank, because it will really come together and create an overall aesthetic appeal. All right, so number five, probably one of the more important ones.
Yeah, the mistake here is adding aggressive fish first. So I've got this fish list, I got a fish plan. Maybe the only available fish are, you know, right now is some aggressive ones, some more aggressive ones, and then I have plans to add more later down the road. But actually, you know, when it turns out I add those other fish down the road, it doesn't turn out very well because aggression and territory means they just get super stressed out.
Yeah, they fight with each other. So like there's a lot of times where people like the Tang Police out there will tell you, you can only have one yellow tang in your tank. That's absolute nonsense. It's not true. But if you add a yellow tang now, let it get established for a year and go ahead and try to add another one, you're probably gonna have problems, right? So if I wanna have, you know, two, three yellow tangs in my tank, I should add them all at once up front. And one of the things you can think about too is aggression isn't universal. So like the yellow tangs actually will probably not ever go after my gobies or whatnot.
Right.
They go after each other.
Yeah.
So think about like aggression in terms of like actually one of the easiest ways to think of me if you don't know about the fish that much is think about their food source. So they're aggressive about territory and food source. So if they're fish that peck at the rock for algae all day, they're probably gonna like be mad when the other ones go after their food source,
that's
right?
True.
So that's one of the easiest ways. But really, like, you know, ask your peers, you know, hopefully you have somebody at a fish store or even an online supplier that you really trust. Ask them about your specific fish choices or your fish plan and what the best way to introduce them is, because you can have like almost any array of fish if you introduce them in the correct manner. All right, so related to that is number six.
Yeah, this is not using an acclimation box to add new, especially the aggressive fish to your tank. So, I mean, boxes that you can sit inside the tank and get the other tank inhabitants used to that fish being around. You're probably gonna see a few, you know, come and check out the box, maybe even try to attack the box. But, you know, you do that over a week or a couple weeks or however long it takes. And then their addition into the rest of the tank, they're more familiar with them.
Generally a little bigger than this one, but you can, you know, find an acclimation box. I think eShop sells them. You can put them in the tank, and they're a big area for the fish to swim around in. They get used to each other, and it's just a way, way, way safer way to introduce a new fish to the tank. They can live in those boxes for a pretty considerable amount of time.
Right.
So it's way better that they have a smaller area and protected from the other fish than it is just letting them go. All right, so the number seven fail I see a lot with reef tanks is?
This is not realizing the aggression dispersion, in which case like six aggressive fish, probably better than just two aggressive fish.
If you watched our clownfish harem series, you'll have seen that for sure.
Yeah.
Like three clownfish often don't do well, but 30 just fine, you know? And so the big thing there is that the most dominant fish, you know, tends to go and pick battles, but it can pick battles with 28 or 29 other fish rather than just picking on the one, and they can easily get lost in the mix. So often, rather than having two tangs, you know, a little school of six tangs often does better. So there's a lot of, depending on the size of your tank, of course, but like there's a lot of things just think about, you know, that if you have one weak one, one strong one, it might actually just work out that the dominant one's there, but it also might work out that it just ends up picking on it to death, you know, literal death in this
case. Yeah, true.
So you really consider it, and again, talk to your fish store, talk to your online trusted place, but like, make sure that you're considering when you're adding these things that sometimes more is actually better than less. All right, so number eight, you've actually heard me hint at this already a couple of times, but the real deal is?
Yeah, the mistake is buying the cheapest fish available instead of buying from somebody that you trust. Guilty of this one myself when I was filling a 125-gallon tank. I want to put as many fish as I can in here, and for me, going and seeking out the cheapest fish was the fastest way to do that.
Yeah, so it doesn't mean you have to break the bank either.
Yeah.
Just go find a fish store in your area with somebody that you trust, build a relationship with. They'll order the fish for you. These are your pets. You don't need them like you need a candy bar, right? Like you can wait a week or two. They'll get you healthy pets from somebody that you trust. It will tell you if they look sick or they need help or whatever. And I'll just say in general, pets that are on sale aren't necessarily the healthiest pets. And you're also putting them in a box with your other pets, so you're putting all those guys at risk. So I would just say that, you know, regardless if it's an online shop or if it is a local fish store, you know, build a relationship with somebody that you trust and buy your pets from that person, not necessarily just because it's gonna save you 10 bucks. Okay, so number nine, this one's super important. Stop gambling on the tank. Stop just rolling the dice. If you're a flip and a quarter in this case, it isn't heads or tails. You're actually hoping for it to land on the edge. So what is it?
Yeah, so stop making the mistake of adding ick magnets to your tank without QT. I mean, we all have an idea of what the ick magnets are. These are the fish with a thin slime coat or a thinner slime coat synonymous with powder blues, powder browns, Achilles tangs, and a variety of other different fish that are just susceptible to stress and even more susceptible to ick.
Yeah, so just stop doing it. Like, it's gonna have a bad outcome. Or if you really want those fish, get them from somewhere that does proper quarantine. And proper quarantine you can identify really quick because it's expensive.
Yeah.
Or do it yourself, learn about quarantine and do it on all of your fish. But there's just no reason to take these fish that are literally flipping the corner, hoping to land on edge. Not just for that fish, but all the other fish in the tank that are gonna get sick too. So really just stop doing those things and get fish that are known to do well in your system. All right, number 10. I actually hear people say this all the time, how many fish can I have?
Yeah.
And that's the wrong question.
Yeah, the failure here is instead of considering the number of fish, think about their territory and the territory of the different fish. If you're gonna add a, you know, 5 or 6 fish that all like to hang out on the rocks and go in and out of the holes, probably gonna have some aggression there. Same thing with the algae eaters. So if you have a whole bunch of fish that are fighting for the same plot of algae chewing or munching opportunity in the tank, you're probably gonna have a problem there. So think about their territory.
Yeah, so like if you wanna get a good mix of fish, like think of some of them that are sand dwellers, some of them that perch on the rocks, some of them that eat algae off the rocks, some of them school open water, some of them that actually school but like to hang out inside the acros. Mm-hmm. Just think about where their habitat is. And actually, you can get quite a few fish if you're thinking about it more about habitat than you are maximum number of fish per gallon. Okay, so number 11 is not understanding what reef safe with caution actually means.
Yeah, so half of it's about just the type of fish, but the other half is about whether or not the fish is hungry and what he's gonna go after when he is hungry. So, I mean, you hear about people asking if, coral beauties or angel fish, if they're reef safe. And some say, well, I've never seen mine pick at corals. And then others say, no, they've completely eradicated some colonies and coral colonies in my tank. And really, it probably comes down to half of it being how much that fish is getting fed.
Yeah, so it is 50% like DNA, right? Like it just happens. Like you never know. You put the fish in there, it might go after corals, it might not, right? The other half of it is absolutely like any organism on the planet. Mm. If you are starving it, it will go after foods that it likes less. And eventually you'll just train it that type of food is a legit option and they'll gain a taste for it. So if you want to go after some of those reef safe with caution, fish that are generally okay, but sometimes not, make sure that you're feeding the tank adequately. And so actually go into that with that mindset that I'm actually going to help solve that specific problem by making sure that I have a proper nutrition program for this fish. Not just I'm feeding enough and frequently enough, but also types of foods that it's going to prefer over everything else. All right, number 12. I got a reef safe with caution fish, but it's eating all my corals or attacking other fish. I need to get it out. This is one of the coolest ways that you can actually try to get it out.
Yeah, the mistake here is not using the red light trick to catch a problem fish.
So a lot of fish simply don't see the red spectrum.
Yeah.
So while you can see what's going in the tank, they can't. So, it works for me. If you can get next to the tank, turn the reds on real quick, and then you can scoop in the net and catch them because they're just kind of flustered. They don't know what just happened. Catch them totally off guard. And they will get smart eventually that you're chasing them if you do it this way. So you got to do it right the first couple of times. But one of the things you can do is actually just turn them on red and then get like a little rod or something and see if they can see the rod instead of trying to, they get spooked by the net pretty quickly.
Mm.
So just see if they're getting spooked and if they can see what's going on, then you know that this might be a good path for you. But catching fish is one of the biggest problems. So this might be just one of the easiest ways for you to do it. Your LED lights probably have that red channel, so try it out. So number 13 is actually increasingly becoming a pet peeve of mine.
Yeah, this is not considering long-term dietary needs. So we make the analogy of eating something like McDonald's every single day, all day, for multiple years. You're gonna live, but will you thrive and will you survive? I mean, the same kind of goes for our fish, a varied diet.
Yeah, so a varied diet can be an inclusive diet. It doesn't mean you have to feed 15 different things a day. It can be one thing that has a bunch of those things all together.
Yeah.
But in general, just thinking about the nutrition of the fish, and this is the one piece I just want to get totally out of everybody's head. fish just die. It's one of those things. Yeah, no. I don't know why the anthias just die. Well, maybe it's because it's a super active fish, is burning calories like constantly.
Yeah.
So we need to be adding calories constantly. So if that fish makes your fish plan, understand that you're going to be feeding it frequently. Like, find a way to get an auto feeder to feed it, you know, multiple times a day with a food that it likes, right? Consider foods that are actually closer to their natural diet instead of feeding them, you know, big old mysis shrimp that they kind of try to gobble down. You know, go to the colanis, which is tiny little pods that are much more similar to the plankton that they type that fish eats. So think about the fish, think about their diet, and you'll have, you know, not a fish that lives for a handful of years,
right,
but one that thrives for, you know, possibly decades. I've had fish that have lasted, I still have fish that have been in my first tank ever, you know, 15 years ago. So, you know, you can be successful much, much longer if you think about the dietary needs of the fish, and it isn't expensive, just put a little bit of effort into it. All right, number 14, kind of like feeding, but it's actually habitat. So another thing we should think about?
Yeah, the mistake here is to not think about flow needs of the fish. So as you can tell by some fish who, especially long tanks, or who sit right in front of a power head and just swim like crazy, the flow, the higher amount of flow is even kind of what they prefer. Better for them, probably. There's other fish that are just so docile and delicate that if you try to put them in this turbulent reef tank, they get blown around, or they only hang out in the small eddies where there is no flow, and they really just don't get to use the space very much. So thinking about the type of fish and the flow that's going on in your tank is better for them.
Yeah, I think a good example of that is like a copper band butterfly. It's already like a finicky fish. It's hard to eat whenever or feed it. And you know what? Like, also float. I have not seen one do well in a high flow tank. Maybe yours, it works out, but I have not seen it. And it's just a super docile fish. It does not like getting blown around. So it tends to go hide in one area of the tank, and it just doesn't do well. It gets stressed out in that area.
Yeah.
But in lower flow tanks is where I've seen some of them successful. Doesn't mean you will be successful with that hard fish, but like, think about the flow needs of the fish and you'll probably be more successful. So nutrition, environment, flow, all those things, and you'll probably be way more successful when you're building out that fish list. So 15 is also real close to that, considering.
Yeah, this is the mistake of not considering the fish size and tank size. So these fish will grow to their natural size that they will in the wild. So in which case, like, I might not put a big fish in a small tank, or I shouldn't. And this is kind of where that term Tang Police probably came from. But, you know, think about how big your tank is, how long your tank is. Maybe it's tall, but not as long. But so tank dimension and the type of fish that you're putting in there.
Yeah, like, this is just a big deal. So most of them, like, will tell you some kind of range if you're going to buy online. Fish store will tell you as well. So, you know, listen to them and understand that, like, I'm trying to build out this tank to be successful for a long time. And there are certain size fish that will match your size tank. All right, number 15 is actually a fail too, though, and the absolute opposite of that.
Yeah, this is feeling like this is going to be your forever tank. So the I need to only put fish in a 40 breeder that will fit for a 40 breeder for the rest of my career in the reefing hobby. So in which case, like, then I'm missing out on the opportunity to use utilitarian type of fish as they're small. And then, you know, what's inevitable? We're all probably going to upgrade at some point after a year, 2 years of success. I'm going to think about a bigger tank or a different size tank that I can now move that fish to where it's more conducive to, like, a longer tank and growing it out long period of time.
I did not get married to my 40-gallon breeder, right? We just went on some first dates.
Yep.
And so eventually I will probably get a bigger tank. And so, like, if you have a tank where it's maybe not perfect for a yellow tang or whatnot, like, know that, you know what? If it is okay for the next 2-3 years, absolutely that is a viable option. Anybody who tells you that it isn't, I don't even know where that comes from, to be honest, because you can absolutely trade them out with somebody else, you know, get a bigger or smaller one. You will, if you're successful with your 40 breeder for 3 years, the chances that you're going to upgrade that tank are super duper high.
Yeah.
So you don't have to treat it like it's your forever tank, but know that going into it, that I've made some choices, that I'll have to make some choices later, you know, 2-3 years from now, mm-hmm. I'm gonna have to decide whether or not this is my forever tank, in which case I may trade for some smaller fish and let these guys go to a more appropriate home. It's not like a shark where there's like no other tanks on the planet in the right. neighborhood that's available. There's plenty of other homes for a yellow tang. Or that I'm probably gonna upgrade, and this is a good reason to do that. My pets have been super successful. I've grown them from here to here, and it just makes like sense to get a bigger yard. All right, so number 17, this is actually the easiest way to protect the healthier fish.
The mistake here is not using a net top, and I can't think of how many people are not guilty of this and have seen a fish jump out of their tank, come out the next day to a fish, you know, carpet surfing, but, you know, we can easily solve that issue just by making a net top, putting it on top, and then being wise enough to remember to put it on there every time, because it's that one time you don't put it back that you come out to a fish laying on your floor.
Yeah, in fact, for me, actually we sell a lot of like tree net top for this reason, but where this actually came from is we would sit on our couch, and then every once in a while, I would see like the cow jump over the moon. Like right, this Lubutii wrasse would jump right over across the TV in front of us. You just see him, like what? And eventually I had egg crate on there, but it was really hard to manage and it blocked a lot of light.
Yeah.
And then I found somebody's project on screen net top, did it myself, found out that there's actually a local place that builds or that sells that clear netting here in Minneapolis. And that was one of the very first products that Bulk Resupply actually offered. But been the solution kind of ever since then to keep fish in our tanks rather than jumping the moon while you're watching TV. So if you don't use this, expect to lose a fish at some point in time. They get spooked, they jump out. Yeah. It happens all the time. So really use the screen net top and protect your pets. Okay, so number 18 is actually super important, and I bet you most of you have actually done it because I have. Mm.
Yeah, this is not matching the difficulty of the fish to your skill level or skill set to take care of them. And even to some degree, your desire to take care of a difficult fish. So maybe you have the skill level too, but you don't want to. So we just don't choose that fish. Or you have, and this is specifically related to like dietary needs most commonly, where they have very particular feeding habits that you need to be available to do daily and willing to do daily to take care of them and live them happy, thriving fish. And sometimes we just miss that.
Yeah, so at one point, I really, really wanted a husky dog, right?
Yeah.
But then I learned like how much like effort needs to go into this specific pet that likes to run, right? It's born for that.
Yeah.
And then it just shows that that's not the right pet for me because I don't have the yard that it was available for it, and I don't have the willingness to take it to the dog park twice a day.
Right.
You know? And because of that, actually, the breeder wouldn't even sell it to me.
Oh,
which,
yeah.
Bravo to her.
Yeah.
Right? And so in this case, the same thing. So pretty much anybody's gonna sell you any fish you want. So you gotta be your own barrier in this case. But like a copper band takes an expert level to try to get it to eat consistently.
Yeah.
You might just luck out, but that's not like a really good way to approach it, right?
Luck. Yeah.
Yeah, and so, and like for me, most of you that have been watching for a while know that I really like the like four-wheeler signal gobies, that sand sifters, and they tend to die, right? They don't when I'm willing to feed food into the sand right in front of them every single day. But what I've learned is I'm not going to do that for the next 10 years.
Right.
I'm gonna do it for the next 10 months, right? And so I'm just not going to select pets that, I don't know if there's a skill level in this case, because I actually know what to do.
Right.
But now that I know what to do, I can also just say, I'm unwilling to do it, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, match all those things and make sure that when it says advanced and all that stuff, really what it means is pain in the butt. All right, so number 19. Of all the things that I think is smoke and mirrors in the hobby, this is it.
Yeah, this is not researching what quarantine really means prior to you getting the fish. So, I mean, you could probably go into some fish stores, you could probably go into, you definitely could go to some websites and see their quarantine procedure and have the owner or have the person that's conducting the quarantine explain to you step-by-step process of what's going on, and then trust that quarantine is getting done right in that situation. And then you can go to other places and it says, yeah, the fish are quarantined, or yeah, we have a quarantine system in the back. And really, that might just mean that we watch them for a couple days and then throw them out on the shelves.
I'm gonna say it like it is. This is garbage, total, total garbage. So here's the thing, is quarantine can mean like I've isolated the fish, I'm just gonna watch it and see if it gets sick. However, for that to work to some degree, even the most minimal degree if that to work, it had to be isolated and not with other fish. Because the moment you add another fish, all of a sudden it is not quarantined. It's hanging out with other things that are potentially sick. You just haven't seen it yet, right? And so the other things is like more proactively, you know, that I'm treating it for, you know, flukes, I'm treating it for ick or for velvet or any of these things, and I'm treating it medicated. However, in this case, if you do that, you have to maintain, you know, your copper levels at a certain point. If it drops below that, and they have to sit in it for like 2 to 3 weeks, and it has to sit in there, if it drops below that for just an hour,
done.
You have to start all over again, right? And so here's the thing, is you can ask the people what quarantine really means, but like you're gonna have to build some trust, right? The online ones that I've seen is absolutely, if you go read the fine print, it says we visually assess the health.
Yeah.
Visually assess health is not anything quarantine. And nobody would define that way. So, you know, I don't say that to bash all the people saying they're quarantined. I'm saying that for you to have proper expectations when you're looking at it. Ask the questions, and maybe I'm wrong with the person that you're dealing with, which in that case, man, means you can earn some trust with that person, and that is your trusted resource for your pets at that point. And like, one of the ways you'll know is because they're more expensive.
Oh yeah.
You know, if I'm gonna feed that fish for a month before that I get it to you, I'm gonna have all the costs of treating it and getting rid of any of the parasites or diseases that it might have. It's not gonna cost the same as the one that just flew in and I sold it to you, right? And so I know that people kind of balk at Elliot at Marine Collectors who does proper quarantine, like a proactive one. Mm. You know, like, well, I don't wanna pay $175 for a yellow tank. I don't either, man, to be honest. Yeah. Nobody wants to pay that. But if you do the math on it, like, he's charging $3 a day for to go select, you know, the right pet for you, a healthy one from the bunch, you know, right at the point in which they enter the country.
Yep.
Then he's feeding it every day. Then he's treating it, maintaining all of those medications and everything for you, and shipping you a healthy eating pet that isn't going to add any parasites or disease to your tank. Think that's worth $3 a day. I'll just get fish slower than I would have normally. But what we can also do is just do it at home. You can learn how to quarantine properly at home, skip all that, get the fish a lot cheaper, just buy from the place that openly states, I don't quarantine. And in fact, in many cases, if you learn how to do this well, you can save the fish. You can go and find the fish that are visibly sick, use your skill set, and bring them back to life in a way that other people probably would have killed it. I mean, you can be super, super proud of your skill set and what you're doing for the hobby. So just understand what quarantine means, do your research behind it, and just don't assume that because it says, you know, quarantine on it, that everything is good. Okay, so number 20, most of everyone I've met actually hasn't picked one of these two paths. They've actually picked head in the sand. Let's take our heads out of the sand and pick an intelligent path and do either one to the best of our ability.
Yeah, the mistake here is not choosing the path of ick management or ick eradication. Very two different things that you've heard us talk about a couple times. But I mean, in this case, I can either go through this entire process of ick eradication, which is the quarantine procedures, properly quarantine procedures, and just put all the effort up front so that way down the road, it's just not something I have to worry about. Or I can put all the effort in throughout the course or the life of my tank and manage ick, knowing that it's probably there, but I'm doing everything I can to keep it at bay.
So if you do the quarantine method, like all the fish that are not available to you really are now available.
Yeah.
Like all the powder blues and powder browns and the Achilles tangs and whatnot that I've gotten from Elliot at Marine Collectors, all healthy.
Fine.
Because we've treated them and we've gotten rid of these things prior to getting them here, right? All the cases that we've tried, or not all, but most of the cases we've tried other than that, like really, those types of fish don't do well and we should just avoid them, you know, based on one of our fails or earlier.
Right.
So here is the thing. You are doing one of these three things. You are either doing proper quarantine up front. Proper meaning, not only do I know what I need to do, but I did it right.
Mm-hmm.
Or you're doing ick management, or I just don't know it, and I'm not doing either one of those. I got head in the sand.
Yeah, dump and pray. And
so don't be the third one.
Yeah.
Do one of the other two, and at least do it to your best of your ability. You don't have to do all the things, but you can do some of them. So in this case, if I'm going to do ick management, and when I say ick, I'm really actually talking about disease management, mm-hmm. because a lot of this stuff will flow over.
Right.
So one is think about nutrition. Healthy, well-fed organisms are better able to fight off disease. So think about their nutrition and do, this could probably cost you an extra $3 a month.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so just put a little extra effort into it. Most people like feeding the fish, so just put a little extra effort in there. And then also, you can go ahead and think about a UV. UV mm-hmm. is not a required element, but what will happen is we'll remove all of the free swimming ick and stop them from attacking the fish. So they fall off the fish when they go to reproduce. Now, when they do reproduce, we can actually sterilize them so that they don't just continue the cycle. We can reduce the total population of these parasites in the tank to something closer to the ocean than just letting them go wild.
Yeah, it's a solid tool in our toolbox in this ick management. And also, you know, related to that is just general stability of the tank.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, a stressed out fish is likely, you know, more, likely higher chances of it, you know, getting the ick and then overcome by ick and things like that, especially those, you know, really sensitive ick ones. But if we maintain, you know, stable temperature, stable water parameters, stability in, you know, lighting schedule, flow schedules, and I mean, we don't change this fish's environment like completely upside down, and it has a better chance of keeping and warding off those types of things.
That's one of those things that a lot of people will say. It's like, oh, I've never had an ick problem. And then I had a power outage, and then it wiped out my whole tank.
Yeah.
So, like, you saw a power outage, the tank got super cold, or, you know, less oxygen in the tank, stressed out the fish. All of a sudden, their immune system was unable to produce the mucus coat that they needed to fend off the ick that was already in the tank. And then it just explodes, right? You know, one turns into 2,000, 2,000 turns into God knows how many.
Yeah.
So if there's one thing I'd like all of you to take away more than anything else, it's put as much effort into thinking about the types of fish that you're gonna put into the tank before it gets a single gallon of water as you do the pumps, the skimmer, the plumbing, the lighting. If you do that, you'll just be way, way, way more successful because you went into this with a working plan.
So from the jump, we should probably get into this eyes wide open and pick a path of whether you're going to go down that ick and disease eradication or ick and disease management. And if you want an idea of how to be successful on either one of those paths, Ryan and I have the live stream where we talk in depth about both of those paths and how to be successful at them. And you can check that out before you get your very first fish right here.